This is Eitan Weinstein.
And I'm Naor Menninger, and you're listening to Two Nice Jewish Boys.
This podcast is made in collaboration with the Jewish Journal. Check them out at jewishjournal.com. Also in collaboration with Arutz Sheva, israelnationalnews.com. If you'd like to support the podcast, visit 2njb.com/donate. In a free democratic state, every person is innocent until proven guilty and is entitled to a fair trial. That seems simple enough. However, sometimes the rule of law doesn't quite line up so perfectly with our personal sense of judgment. In 1986, a man by the name of John Demjanjuk was extradited from Cleveland, Ohio to Israel. Demjanjuk was accused of being Ivan the Terrible of Treblinka, a notorious guard who would torture Jewish prisoners before they entered the gas chambers at the second deadliest Nazi extermination camp. Before Demjanjuk stood trial in Israel, he needed representation. No one in Israel was willing to defend the man that most believed to be one of the cruelest perpetrators of crimes against humanity. That is, until Yoram Sheftel came along. Today, we are joined by attorney at law, Yoram Sheftel, to talk about the Demjanjuk case.
Well, first of all, I have to correct your introduction.
Okay.
There was one lawyer which was willing to defend Demjanjuk. However, he wanted upfront $1 million plus personal bodyguard, plus a transformation of his family outside of Israel during the entire trial, and on and on and on, all kind of such demands. Mm-hmm. But there was a much more significant one who was ready to represent Demjanjuk, and that's the retired
retired judge
of the Supreme Court, Chaim Cohen.
Really?
Which 3 weeks before the trial started said that he would join joyfully Yoram Sheftel at the defense at the defense chamber. But in order to make sure that Demjanjuk will be acquitted, because the entire evidence against him, it's identification after 35, 40 years, which from the legal point of view was nothing, and only his physical unhealthy situation prevents him from doing it.
Circumstantial evidence at best.
Chaim Cohen is one of the founding fathers of Israeli
law.
He
was the deputy president of the Israeli Supreme Court, and he said that the very fact that Demjanjuk was indicted, it's a travesty of justice.
So I don't think we could have hoped to start the episode better with two scoops. That there were two other attorneys that, and also I guess I couldn't have expected to read an introduction to a podcast to an attorney at law and not be corrected. So I guess that's expected. But I want to start by asking this. After you've seen the, I don't know at what point they interviewed you for the show. There was a recent, for our listeners, there was a recent documentary that was released on Netflix called The Devil Next Door.
Yeah, and this is a television series which I can characterize as full of lies and deception deliberately.
Like any documentary, almost.
I don't know any.
You know,
I don't know any. But this one took out of it the entire ruling of the Court of Appeal, the Federal Court of Appeal
entire
in the
process.
USA.
In the USA.
In the USA, which ruled that the entire case of Demjanjuk, it's a cover-up and frame-up, and Demjanjuk not only is not even the terrible, but is a victim of a fraud on the court, as it says clearly in the verdict of the Federal Court of Appeal.
Before he was extradited?
After he was extradited, and this is what the Federal Court of Appeal, Sixth Circuit, which sits in Cincinnati, ruled in 17th of November 1993, 10 weeks after Demjanjuk was acquitted. As early as 1978 or 1979, the government had information from official sources within the Soviet Union, including that there were two Ukrainian operators of the gas chambers in Treblinka, Ivan and Nikolai, and that Ivan Grozny, Ivan the Terrible, was a man named Ivan Marchenko, not Ivan Demjanjuk. The OSI attorneys acted with reckless disregard for their duty to the court and their discovery obligations in failing to disclose at least three sets of documents in their possession before the proceedings against Demjanjuk ever reached trial. And then the court says, for reasons set out herein, we vacate the judgment of this court and the judgment of this, the judgment of the district court and the judgment of this court in the extradition proceedings on grounds that the judgment were wrongly produced as a result of prosecutional misconduct that constitute fraud on the court in the circumstances of this case.
So, but in the series, they pointed out to that point.
No,
that,
they did not. They eliminated the entire thing of this verdict.
They didn't mention this. But on that same point, they did mention, and I just want to point it out to you so that you can respond, that they mentioned that Demjanjuk wrote in some play in the immigration, I think, forms to the United States that his father was Demjanjuk and his mother was Marchenko.
It's always, you see, it's half-truths, and sometimes half-truths is much worse than a lie and a half.
It's a Yiddish proverb?
This is originally in Mamelushin. Look, Demjanjuk didn't have a clue about the maiden name of his mother. Therefore, he said that her name was Marchenko.
But isn't that quite coincidental that he chose the same name?
Listen to the end, you will see nothing is okay. Incidental. Marchenko in Ukrainian, it's exactly like Cohen and Levi with us, the Jewish people. How do I know? In the telephone book of Cleveland, not of Kiev, of Cleveland, 611 Marchenkos. And we produced it to the court. Now, but why arguing about this when we produced the birth certificate of the mother of Demjanjuk, which says that her maiden name was Tabachuk? So this is all one big crap, deliberate, brought by prosecutors, which are liars and bloodthirsty, which even when the entire dossier of the real Ivan the Terrible, Marchenko, Ivan Marchenko, came to surface, they still wanted to hang Demjanjuk for being Ivan the Terrible, this bloodthirsty prosecutors. And there is no other way you can describe them except bloodthirsty, cynical, with total disregard to the facts and the truth.
So I want to ask, if we take a step back from the case, because the case is, and in a court of law, things are very specific. You need to prove, if you're accusing that he is Ivan the Terrible, you need to prove that he is Ivan the Terrible. But if we take a step back, and if I want to ask you, is there any doubt in your mind that he was a Nazi, at least a Nazi collaborator, that he committed crimes against humanity?
First of all, this entire conversation is false. And it came to surface when our bloodthirsty prosecutors realized that they lost the case of Ivan the Terrible. Then they started to say, okay, he's not Ivan the Terrible, so he's another terrible Ivan. And then the Supreme Court ruled as follows in the last sentence of its verdict. The accused, Ivan the Wachman Ivan Demjanjuk, we find him not guilty from the disastrous charges of being Ivan the Terrible from Treblinka. The following day, within 48 hours, 12 petitions to the Supreme Court were produced to the court, demanding the general attorney to prosecute Demjanjuk as a Wachman from Sobibor. Why? Because that's what the Supreme Court said in his verdict. Yes.
Okay.
2 weeks are passing, and the general attorney announced the court the following: we shall not prosecute Demjanjuk on any alternative charge relating to the Holocaust. Why we will not do it? We will not do it because we do not have sufficient evidence to secure a guilty sentence, and a second non-guilty sentence will be a complete disaster. And then our clever Supreme Court, which only less than a month ago said the Wachman Ivan Demjanjuk, then suddenly the Supreme Court said the following: the general attorney is fully correct. Why should he prosecute Demjanjuk if the chances of conviction are very small? Therefore, the general attorney is right and dismissed the entire 12 petitions. And this, we're talking about Sobibor, we're talking about any alternative charges.
What do you believe? You believe he had nothing to do with the Holocaust whatsoever?
Look, as far as Ivan the Terrible, it is not a matter of belief, because never in the 20th century, in a magnificent trial, you know, that the media cover and everything, never the defendant was able to prove his innocence to a degree that Demjanjuk did. Demjanjuk produced 80 statements from 37 Wachmans, including 11 statements from Nikolai Shelaev, the co-operator of the gas chambers in Treblinka, which pointed black on white at Ivan Marchenko as his partner in operating the gas chamber in Treblinka.
But I'm asking about
One second. 80 statements like this, each and every one of them pointing at Ivan Marchenko and Nikolai Shelaev, including Nikolai Shelaev himself, his statements. He was caught by the KGB. He was tried. He was found guilty. He was executed to death, like all these 37 Wachmans. Yes? And they all stated, plus 5 laborers, Ukrainian forced laborers, women, all stated as Ivan Marchenko, as Ivan the Terrible. So here, there is no question that Demjanjuk is not Ivan the Terrible, because we know who he is. And you cannot be Ivan the Terrible and being the same person and not being Ivan the Terrible. It's two different persons, nothing to do between one and another. And I want to show you there is also, there is not even the slightest physical resemblance. That's Ivan the Terrible. That's the real Ivan the Terrible. And that's also Ivan the Terrible.
Right, these are the photos. They also show it in the documentary.
To me, this photograph showing that the Holocaust, it's a joint venture between the Nazi cross and the Christian cross. Because you see, here is the Nazi cross, and here is the Christian one in their room. And the entire Holocaust, it's a joint venture between the Christian cross and the Nazi cross. And this picture represents it. Now let's look at Demjanjuk. No physical resemblance whatsoever. Nothing. Mm-hmm. And this is what the court, the Supreme Court of the State of Israel said. Not only it's a mistake. Look, this is Demjanjuk in 1951.
Yeah.
You see? Yeah. No resemblance whatsoever to Ivan Marchenko. Okay. Besides, Ivan Marchenko is 9 years older. He was in Treblinka married, a father of three. In 1942, Demjanjuk was 22 years old, bachelor. He married in 1950.
But so then how...
Now, this is the terrible story.
Yes, but
now,
what about having anything to do with Sobibor or look, Treblinka as a simple guard, let's say?
Look.
Can you deny it completely?
Yes, I deny it completely because our general attorney, our Supreme Court ruled that there is no sufficient evidence to implicate Demjanjuk to anything concerned the Holocaust.
So I have a follow-up question. Let's say Demjanjuk approached you, okay, and in a close conversation, you're his attorney. He would tell you, I'm not Ivan the Terrible. Yes, I was a guard. Would you represent me?
No.
You wouldn't represent
Definitely
him.
Not.
Okay.
Definitely not. But he denies...
He denied any
connection whatsoever for the accusations of being a Wachmann anywhere.
So you would...
Okay. So I have two questions on that point. One is... What do you say about the German conviction later on in 2009? And two, in the series, and maybe this was taken out of context, but in the series, his grandson seems to implicate at the end or imply that he's somehow come to terms with the fact that his father is
He never said that this is what his grandfather told him.
Yeah. No, he says that he's sort of...
Who the hell is he?
No, I know.
What authority he has to say what was his grandfather or was not? Look, if he
No, you could say that he's a person
well, look,
that has the most interest if, to believe if, that his grandfather's innocent.
Except from...
Not true whatsoever. And again, the important thing about the foolish things which he said in Netflix is that he never said and never even indirectly hinted that he heard this from his grandfather. So his own stupid thoughts are totally not...
And what about the German conviction in 2009?
Well, the German conviction, it's a farce because it's based on the same, exactly one-on-one material which the Israeli Supreme Court of the Jewish state, the highest court of the land, said that this material is not sufficient to produce an indictment. Now, the German court for 1 second didn't believe in the conviction he just published because a second after the verdict was read in the court, he released Demjanjuk. He asked the lawyer of Demjanjuk, are you going to appeal against our conviction? The lawyer said, yes, okay, we release your client.
But wasn't he sentenced to 5 years
yes,
in prison?
Yes, and on the spot was released after this 5 years sentence. This you will not find in the Netflix.
Wait, he spent 5 years?
No, he didn't spend 1 minute. He was in arrest during the case. 12 times he asked to be released on bail. He was denied. Why? Because such a serious charges, you never release someone on bail. But then when he was convicted and found guilty in these same charges, he was released on the spot in the initiative of the court. He was released on the spot.
Okay.
On the spot. And this is the most clear-cut evidence that this German court, which I characterize the proceedings in the German court as prostitution of the Holocaust. This is a clear-cut prostitution of the Holocaust.
But didn't he die in Germany?
He died as a free man.
So he...
As a free man.
He chose to stay in Germany?
No, he had to
He was expecting
for the appeal proceedings.
I see. Yeah.
Besides, he couldn't go back to the United States because he was deported. So he couldn't go back to the United States under any circumstances. Okay. I would assume if he had a choice, he would go to Ukraine to finish his last days. Yes, but one thing is for sure, he couldn't go back to the United States. But the point is that the German court, which refused to release him when he was only under indictment, released him when he was found guilty. I mean, that's a joke. And we're talking about law. The conviction is non-existent. Why? Because he appealed against it. The appeal wasn't heard, not because of his fault. He simply died. Therefore, by German law,
he's innocent.
He's innocent.
They emphasize on the show, by the way.
Yes.
In the end.
Yes.
So this is a yes. So why do you think? Because he was first extradited from the United States to Israel and then again to Germany by the OSI, the Office of Special Investigations.
He was not extradited. He was deported.
He was extradited either, and then deported.
Yes. Either to Germany or Poland or Ukraine.
Yeah.
Now you know what's the secret here.
Mm-hmm.
The German bastards waited till the last Treblinka survivor will die. And then they accepted Demjanjuk. You know why? Because when Demjanjuk put on trial as being a Wachmann in Sobibor from March 43 till October 43, you know who will bring his defense witnesses? The Treblinka survivors that testified against him, that he was in that time exactly in Treblinka. All the survivors in Binyanei Auma, in the theater hall that was transformed not successfully to a court of law, testified they saw Ivan the Terrible, which is Demjanjuk to their account, every day from about August, September 42, till at least the revolt in 2nd of August 43. Therefore, the Germans waited them all to die, and then they were ready to accept him and to put him on trial, the liars. This is why I call the proceedings in Germany clear-cut prostitution of the Holocaust.
Mm-hmm. So I wanted to ask about the OSI in the United States. Why did they have, in your opinion, because it seems like you're painting a picture like this is an innocent man, and the OSI is just kind of
I'm not painting any picture. It's the Federal Court of Appeals saying
I'm saying
that
from
the OSI, the killers.
Yeah.
So why
did they do that?
The OSI, judicial murderers. I'll read you a document from one lawyer of the OSI to another. You know what they say? Releasing our material to the Demjanjuk family will easily undermine the strategy of the Israeli prosecution. What is the strategy of the Israeli prosecution? Gallows now. And also it says, and undermine the integrity of the Israeli prosecution. You know why? Because they are partners in this fraud on the court. The Israeli prosecution are partners in this fraud on the court.
Let's take a step back. First of all, I want to know, why did you become a lawyer?
I became a lawyer because I wanted to be a lawyer. Before I was 10 years old.
Okay.
This is under the influence of the Kastner case, which I read everything about it before I was 10 years old.
The Kastner case, our audience is mainly American Jews, so they would know.
Kastner was the worst Jewish collaborator with the Nazis in the entire Second World War, and he actually assisted Eichmann.
He's a Jewish, and he lived in Israel-Palestine.
In exterminating 700,000 Jews and
Hungarian Jews,
exactly. And when this truce was written in a very small publication in Israel, the Israeli general attorney put this man which wrote about it, Malkiel Greenwald, on a trial
because Kastner was part of government.
Exactly. He was high official of the government.
It was a trial for blasphemy.
Exactly. But criminal one.
Yeah.
But a criminal trial of blasphemy. And
that's 55, the year 55, yeah,
and,
I think.
And very, very quickly it became a case that Malkiel Greenwald through his outstanding lawyer, Shmuel Tamir, became to be the accuser and not the accused. Mm-hmm. And I read everything about this trial, and this when I decided to be a criminal defense lawyer. And also I read the autobiography of the greatest criminal lawyer ever lived, which is of course Jewish, Shmuel Leibovich, Samuel Leibovich. He had 78 murder cases, 77 acquittal.
In America?
In America, Samuel Leibovich. And his real name was Leibo, and he changed it to Leibovich because Leibovich sounds more Jewish.
Well,
so okay, so when the case of Demjanjuk comes to Israel, how do you make the decision to take it on?
Well, at the first 2-3 weeks was convinced, like any other Israelis, that we have here even the terrible, and that's perfectly okay, nothing wrong with it. I didn't pay too much attention to it. However, still, I was reading, I don't know even why, everything that was written about. Very soon, I started with my instincts to feel that the case stinks. First of all, I found out from the papers that the entire case is based on identification proceedings which took place in Israel, in Jaffa, in 1976. That is to say, more than 30 years after the events, after Treblinka happened. And knowing who are the Israeli police, I was sure that it was a total misconduct of photo spreads and a proper identification process. A. B. Within 6 weeks, it emerged that one of the witnesses, the key witnesses, Rosenberg, which is supposed to be a key witness, gave a testimony to a Jewish Austrian newspaper in 1947, claiming that he killed with his own hands Ivan the Terrible in the revolt in 2nd of August 1943. So it's quite difficult to kill a man and then to identify him alive 33 years later. Then it emerged that with another witness, the same story, Goldfarb, which also claimed to be to kill him with his own hands, but to see with his own eyes how during the revolt in 2nd of August 1943, he saw how Ivan the Terrible was killed, and yet he identified Demjanjuk as being Ivan the Terrible. So it was enough for me to doubt the entire proceedings.
In the show, it seemed as if, and maybe this was another one of the way they edited it, but it seemed as if that evidence came up while you were already an attorney. That was before you became attorney?
Of course. Before I became his defense lawyer. This was all put when O'Connor, his American defense lawyer, when he came to Israel, he put these facts to the media, and the prosecution didn't dispute it. The prosecution didn't say he doesn't know what he's talking about. It never happened. Rosenberg never gave such an interview. Goldfarb never said that he watched with his own eyes how Ivan the Terrible being killed in the revolt. They didn't dispute it at all. And we know it's true. It's true. We know more what the prosecution cover up. Rosenberg also gave a 66-page in Yiddish his accounts from Treblinka, and the last 3 pages he described in Yiddish how he killed Ivan the Terrible with his own hands. Now the prosecution, this evidence exists in the Jewish Historical Museum in Warsaw, and I spoke with the head of that institute. And he told me that Shaked was here before the trial. And I told him about this statement, and Shaked was not interested, didn't take it.
Shaked was the prosecutor, yes, for the state.
Yeah,
I had to pay
this head of this Jewish institute $500 in cash, yes, in order that to be able to photocopy this statement. This mm-hmm. how we run.
But you
our
approached
trial.
You approached the Demjanjuk family after you saw that and you heard. There.
No, I didn't know what to do. You see, the more and more the time passed, more and more information came to light that I was then convinced that it's a farce. The entire accusation of Demjanjuk of being Ivan the Terrible is a complete farce. However, and I said to myself, I want to be part in the defense team. I never realized that I will be the sole defense lawyer in that case.
Eventually.
As it happened, eventually, yes. But I wanted to be part of the defense team and especially concentrate on the identification proceedings. But I didn't know what to do. Because if I come to suggest myself, you know, it's Ukrainian goyim. They will think that I'm planted by the Mossad in the case. As O'Connor, by the way, did when me and the family decided to throw him out of the case.
Uh-huh.
So he said that Sheftel planted himself as a Mossad agent in the case. You see? So
that's a pretty shitty Mossad agent to get an appeal and then an innocent.
A stupid anti-Semitic goy. I mean, what you can expect? A stupid anti-Semitic goy. So
I just want to point out to our listeners that they should watch the documentary, if not for anything but to hear the claims about the anti-Semitism. It's not just something that you're throwing around. Meaning there's connections that his father was anti-Semitic, yeah. Right?
I'm not sure at all that O'Connor, who was responsible of refugee matters in the Truman administration, I'm not
senior,
at all...
O'Connor Senior.
Yeah, O'Connor Senior, the father of the defense lawyer. I'm not convinced at all that he was an anti-Semite. I think it's again the crap, the bullshit, the lies and deception.
So he wasn't, but his son was.
I was brought up in a Yiddish home. From birth, we suspect goyim
they're all anti-Semites.
To be anti-Semites. Especially, I'm talking about, I mean, goyim with Yiddish is Christian goyim.
Uh-huh.
Yes? Because Yiddish was not spoken in Muslim countries, of course. So O'Connor definitely when to throw him out of the case was my initiative when I discovered that he's worthless.
The fact
but
that he
why
was
do you, why did you call him why do you call him an anti-Semite? Like why?
Because when he said
that she's a Mossad
when
agent,
he suddenly said that I'm in the case as a Mossad agent.
That's conspiracy.
That's only an anti-Semite but, can say such a thing.
But you know what's amazing?
Only low class anti-Semite can say such
first of all,
crap.
It's amazing that they let him represent because he's not an Israeli lawyer. The
no,
fact
no.
that they
according
let him
the law, no. According the law in Israel, when the accused is a foreigner and he faced death penalty, he's entitled to have a foreign.
It was
lawyer.
Always thus.
Yes. Also, we started completely different between the two cases. Eichmann also had a German foreign defense lawyer.
And another technical issue is that in Israel, correct me if I'm wrong, but in the appeal, you usually don't show new evidence.
Yes, unless you can prove that this new evidence is crucial. A, B, you couldn't get them when the original trial took place.
But it's a rare procedure.
Not so rare.
Not so rare?
Not so rare. I mean, time and again, I succeed in appeal proceedings.
Okay.
To put new evidence.
Okay.
So I want to ask a philosophical question, I guess, about law. Do you believe that a lawyer...
No, but let me finish the question. How?
Okay.
So I came to a dead end.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah.
And then at the morning of the eve of Yom Kippur, I'm going to the main prison in Israel, Ayalon prison, to meet some of my clients there. And I enter to the place where
that's
the lawyers...
That's 50% of the prison population.
And I enter the place where the lawyers sitting and waiting the clients to be brought to them. And who do I see when I enter? I see O'Connor. And I said to myself, now I'm going to mesmerize him and put myself in the case. And so it was. We started the con. I, first of all, told the guard sergeant that when I will talk with my clients, bring me every 10 minutes a cup of coffee and hold O'Connor till I finish. Don't take him to Demjanjuk. And when I came out of that meeting, he says to me, oh, you must be a big shot because they save your coffee 10 minutes. I'm sitting here 2 hours and no one suggested a coffee to me.
Theater.
He said so.
No, I'm saying theater.
Yes. And then we started to discuss and talk. And this was... This led the rest is history. This led to me joining the case.
Your philosophical question, Ace.
So yeah, so I want to ask if you believe that a lawyer has to fully believe in the innocence of his client in order to defend him. I'm not painting a situation in which the client has behind closed doors confessed to the lawyer or anything like that. I'm saying if the client holds that he is innocent, does the lawyer have to completely believe in his innocence, or can he have doubts?
Look, in all the cases I took, and I always take very, very serious and vicious and nasty cases, I don't care if the person I represent is actually innocent or not. I care about the evidence, except one case, and that's the Demjanjuk case, because as false as the identification proceedings may be, they still may be right as well. I mean, the fact that the identification proceedings are false, it means that they cannot serve as an evidence against the accused. But it doesn't say necessarily that they are wrong, that there is a mistake in the identification.
Mm-hmm.
Because there is a possibility of mistaken identification because the proceedings are false, there cannot be sufficient evidence. But it's not one-on-one that if the proceedings are false, then the identification practically is false. It's false legally, but not necessarily practically.
But you're saying in the Demjanjuk case...
Then I said to O'Connor, listen... And also what makes me even more eager to join the case from the evidence point of view, when I discovered that the Demjanjuk Travniki card is a KGB document. It's a KGB document.
It's one of the main evidence of the prosecution.
Again, this is also lies, because this is 100% alibi for Demjanjuk for not putting his foot ever in Treblinka. The evidence, the document put Demjanjuk in two places. Oksau, which is a kind of labor camp with no executions, no gas chambers, no nothing. Forced labor, agriculture forced laborer. And Sobibor. And prosecution expert witness from Germany said that the Travniki card, in every Travniki card, you have all the places when the person was put in. So if Demjanjuk was in Treblinka, it must appear in the Travniki document. But more so, according to the, when you take the witnesses and you take the card, so it should be mentioned three times. Why? Because he was in between Oksau and Sobibor all the time, and after and before in Treblinka, according to the statements. So he was before 22nd of September in Treblinka, should be the first time. He was after the 22nd and before the 27th of March in Treblinka, second time. And after the 27th of March, he should be back again in Treblinka. Why? Because he was there in the revolt. So he should appear three times on the Travniki card, Treblinka, but it doesn't appear at all. So the Travniki card is 100% alibi for Demjanjuk from the accusation of being Ivan the Terrible.
So I want us to hit one last...
But then I said to O'Connor, listen, what I just said to you before, the identification is false for the law, for the court, but maybe it's right. And I'm going to meet with this man and I want to test him.
Look him in the eye.
Looking in the eyes is ghoulish.
It's ghoulish, okay. So what do you do then?
Look, I know from what...
Cross-examine him.
From that time, I knew that Ivan the Terrible pushed to the gas chambers the entire almost 900,000 Jews that were slaughtered in Treblinka and tortured them as well. And each and every one of them screamed Gewalt and Shema Yisrael. Now Shema Yisrael he could hear in Cleveland. There was a Jewish community, 200,000 people. He may have heard Shema Yisrael in Cleveland, but Gewalt not. He couldn't hear Gewalt. And by the way, I don't have any language distance when I speak with Demjanjuk because I speak fluent Russian as well.
Couldn't he have heard it in Ukraine or, I mean, from Jews?
From you in Ukraine?
He didn't speak Yiddish in Ukraine.
He never saw a Jew before he drafted in the army. And in the army also, I doubted if he saw a Jew. And the Jew in the army shouldn't cry Gewalt. Gewalt, you shout when you're extremely desperate.
Okay.
Gewalt is when you're extremely desperate. And for 2.5 hours, I tested his reactions when I... like by coincidence threw to the air the word Gewalt and dropped my key and says Oi Gewalt and got down to take it and look at him when he doesn't look, when he doesn't realize that I look at him and on and on, and after 2.5 hours, and Demjanjuk is a dumb, I mean, er is nicht a klieger goy, he's not a clever goy. There are clever going, but he's not one of them. And he didn't fool me. He didn't fool me. And I was 100% convinced that the word Gewalt he heard the first time in his life in our discussion. And that's plus another condition. We're going to admit all the facts of the indictment, including all the crimes of Ivan the Terrible. And we're going to dispute one thing. Demjanjuk is not even that terrible. He's not that monster. Mm-hmm. It got nothing to do with it.
So I want to hit one last piece of evidence that was brought up in the show, and I want to hear what you have to say with it. One of the most convincing things to me was the tattoo on the under his arm, which he admitted to having and having removed, which was an notorious SS tattoo. So... I mean, doesn't that at least prove that he was a Nazi or that he was a Nazi collaborator or a Wachmann?
Not at all. I mean, he testified about it in the case. And naturally, the Netflix, which is busy only with lies and deceptions, didn't bring his testimony about this in the case.
So what was his testimony?
His testimony is very clear. He was in a prison camp called Chelm, near the city of Chelm, the famous Chelm from Sholem Aleichem. And he was there from summer 42 till spring of 44. It's a complete full alibi to Treblinka and Sobibor and any other death camp. And then he was taken out from that camp in order to join SS unit. And he was stamped the SS tattoo. And 2 weeks later, and he stayed there in Austria, in, I think, near the city of Ganz, something like this. But 2 weeks later, they took him to the Vlasov army.
Which is?
Vlasov army, it's an army of more than half a million Soviet prisoners of war that fell to German hands and volunteer to fight alongside the German, the German Wehrmacht. And Demjanjuk doesn't deny that he was one of them, but there is no question whatsoever that the Vlasov army had nothing to do and didn't kill one Jew. By the way, there were a lot of Jews in the Vlasov army, which saved themselves this way. There were a lot, when I say a lot, few thousand. There were a few thousand Jews in the Vlasov army as well. And the Vlasov army had nothing to do with anything concerned the Holocaust. Nothing whatsoever. Now, when it was after the war, in those camps of refugees, he was told by many, look, if you want to immigrate to the United States, take it off the SS, because otherwise you wouldn't get a visa to the United States. So he took it off. That's the story.
Okay.
That's the story.
Last question.
Now, of course, again, his version about it, I mean, you can believe it, you cannot believe it, but they took it off. They're serious. They were afraid that when he tells it so simple and so clear, yes, with his own mouth, yes, people may believe him. So they took it off. They took it off. But
it is also interesting that he mentioned the tattoo, right?
Yeah, it wasn't.
Yes, he brought it
known.
Up, meaning
yeah,
it wasn't known.
He brought it up. Yes, he brought it. I mean, no one could say that he had here an SS tattoo. He brought it out. He brought it up.
But then going back to your claim that he's stupid, maybe he was just dumb.
Not that stupid. Because you see,
that's the definition.
No. Because you see, he was not stupid enough to leave it when he was told that with this tattoo, he will not get a visa to the U.S. So he took it off.
Uh-huh.
So he took it off.
Yeah.
But look, the entire... after they lost the case, after they realized they lost the case, but before the verdict. Okay, so he's not even the terrible from Treblinka, so he's another terrible Ivan. All this false is based on the Travniki card. Now, the Travniki card is, again, it's a fraud on the court. And this time, it's a pure Israeli fraud on the court. But the court in Israel... doesn't have the guts to say it, as the Federal Court of Appeal had the guts to say it about the prosecutors in the U.S. And the story goes like this. The original Travniki card came to Israel in December 86. In January 87, they sent Amnon Bezaleli, the false witness, expert witness, which supposed to testify in court and say this is 100% original
genuine
original document. And he was sent to Germany, to the BKA, the Federal Forensic Laboratory, which is the number one experts on earth to rule whether a document supposed to be a Third Reich document is authentic or forgery. And the head of that laboratory was given the document. His name is Louis Ferdinand Werner. He came to Mr. Bezaleli the next day and said to him, listen, Bezaleli, this is not a forgery. This is an amateur forgery of the KGB, and I point to you now 3 points, which I'm sure there are many others. The 3 points are the face, alleged the Demjanjuk face, it's a photo montage on the uniform. The entire photograph is taken from another document. And the stamp on the photograph doesn't match the stamp on the document. Leave me the document for another 10 days. I give you a full, detailed expert opinion. What the Israeli prosecution, Amnon Bezaleli, which only seeking the truth, what they do? Bezaleli phoned Jerusalem to his prosecutors and ask them what to do and tell them what Dr. Werner just told him.
He was told, take immediately the document from him and come back to Israel.
Now all, and then Dr. Werner writes a memo. And he writes like this, it seems in this case, the facts are of no matter whatsoever, and everything will be subordinated to the political needs. Now, the entire case of Demjanjuk, including the Supreme Court appeal hearings, the entire case, nobody knows about it. That's fraud on the court, classical. Fraud on the court. How did I discover it? When the entire case, the final arguments completed, Aaron Barak said, due to the twists and turns of this case all the time,
Aaron Barak is the judge.
Yes, of the Supreme Justice Court. Of Supreme the Supreme Court. Court. Later on became the head. President.
Yeah, the president.
Chief Justice. So then Barak appealed to the defense and the prosecution. Look, we don't want to write a verdict, a decision, that afterwards all the world will laugh at us because there are other facts which contradict what we wrote. So if there is certain development which changed the facts as they are now, please let us know. In March, just before 3 months before the verdict, the Stern magazine come with an article, 12 pages. Everything I just told you
was
that's
there.
The basis of the article, including the memo, the full wording of the memo, everything. And I sent it to Barak, although the arguments are closed, and I wrote him a letter. I send it to you and to the other judges, justices, only because you asked. I don't need it. I already proved the case, my case.
Just
I don't
for
need
the
it.
Record.
Just no word about it in the verdict. Nothing. And the entire accusations of Demjanjuk for being Wachmann is this based on this false document. Now, I tell you more than this. The leading forensic expert of the 20th century, Dr. Julius Grant. Yes?
Mm-hmm.
He was a defense witness. And I got him through my connections with the friends of Meyer Lansky, the legendary, which I represented him as well. I had the kuvod to represent him as well when I was 30 years old. And they directed me to Dr. Julius Grant. I know who is Dr. Julius Grant. I tell you just two things, 3 points. A, when the son of Mussolini said that the Mussolini diary are authentic, Dr. Julius Grant took the paper, did like this, and said, this paper was manufactured in the 50s in the region of Lombardia in Italy. That's fraud. And then a chemical test, which he carried, proved it. The same thing exactly with the Hitler diaries. Just from doing like this to the paper, he said, no, this is a paper produced in the 60s in Germany. And then chemical test proved it. As a private person, he was nominated as the head of the Cyprus police after the murder of Archbishop Makarios, and within 3 months, through forensic evidence, he found the killer. That's Dr. Julius Grant. Now, Dr. Julius Grant said about this
like a
document,
real-life Sherlock Holmes.
More than, believe me, much more than Sherlock Holmes. Now, and it's a real one. That's a real, not a fantasy.
Yeah.
Now, Dr. Julius Grant, which testified in the case when he was 87 years old, stood 4 days, refused to sit. 4 days he stood on the witness box. And he said that there is no question whatsoever that the signature on the Demjanjuk case is not the signature of the Demjanjuk that sits in the docks, in the dock here. No question whatsoever. Clear cut.
clear-cut this by comparing more than 30 known undisputed signatures of Demjanjuk from 47 till the late 60s. Clear-cut. Then he said, no question whatsoever that the photograph, as Dr. Werner said, was taken from another document. Why? Because you see clearly there are two little holes which fits exactly staple, and on the document there is no staple holes. So clearly the photograph was taken from another, and this is the two key identification features.
Yeah.
The photograph and the signature. So the Travniki card is a false, is 100% false, and this is the basis of the conviction and the stories and everything you say that Demjanjuk is a Wachmann at large and in Sobibor specifically.
So we
got to wrap things up.
I have one last question. Do you also?
No. Yeah, just
one last question to finish things up, so very shortly. I mean, not today, because I'm not sure also that many people would necessarily know the connection between you and Demjanjuk. But back then, there was certainly, there was even an incident in which someone threw acid on your face.
Yeah.
Back then, I think it's safe to say
and
that
the Jewish
many...
doctor, American Jewish doctor, refused to take money for the operation. He operated me in a special operation that he invented 3 months ago. Yes.
Yeah.
And he refused to take a penny. For me, he said, it's an honor for me to operate you.
So I want to ask, because I think it's safe to say that back then, many, if not most, Israelis had very harsh feelings towards you. And those aren't in the negative sense. How does it feel to be kind of, you know, one of the most hated people?
Look, I thought it's a natural and there was no other way possible. Because, like my mother even, 99.9999% of the Israelis believed that Demjanjuk is Ivan the Terrible. And how come a Jewish lawyer, an Israeli Sabra, a WASP, white Ashkenazi Sabra with protection, represents Demjanjuk, which is Ivan the Terrible? So naturally, look, if I wasn't in the case and I would believe what it's written in the newspapers and what the prosecution
said, he would be dead.
I would be mad myself on an Israeli defense lawyer that represents Demjanjuk.
Right.
So you understand.
So I am very, very angry on the prosecution, which deliberately spread out their lies and deception about this case, which this is the result and the reason why I was more hated than my client. And I admit it. Yes, on them, I'm very angry. Mm-hmm. But not
but
on the
for
people.
You, it's natural that the general public.
Yes, it was the only time in my life which I didn't go to shul. Because I couldn't.
Mm-hmm.
Because of the animosity to me from any congregation, I would step in a shul, synagogue.
Okay, so before we go, the book, your book is in English, but you don't have an electronic version of it, right?
Not that
for
I know.
Kindle. You should totally release it now that you're okay. Look, what I want to tell you is this.
Look, this.
Whether you like it or not, the Netflix documentary. One thing is for sure: it made you an international superstar right now. So you should have it publicized again in a digital version, so that people can read it.
Look, when I was 30 years old, I was all over American television representing Meir Lansky here in Israel.
Okay.
And I tell you more than that. I was a lot on the same American television when I was 22 years old, when I make acquainted with Meir Lansky, when I established a defense league
of Meir Lansky to provide him with Israeli citizenship according to the law of return, because not only is a Jew, he's a very good Jew. He was a very, very good Jew, Meir Lansky. A very, very, very good Jew.
So you're used to it. But anyway, the book, okay, you heard it, guys. The book is called Defending Even the Terrible.
Yes, but even the terrible in quotes. But it has also British version, and it was published in French as well.
You can go to Amazon and buy a secondhand version.
Yeah, and of course, it was originally in Hebrew.
Yeah.
Yeah. But most of our listeners, unfortunately, don't read Hebrew.
In Hebrew, it's called the Demjanjuk Affair, The Rise and Fall of a Short Trial.
Okay.
So thank you. First of all, thank you so much for joining us.
It was fascinating.
Before we go,
we're collaborating with the Jewish Journal, jewishjournal.com, and with Arutz 7, israelnationalnews.com, and we accept donations. So please help us out. Go to ngp.com/donate and help us out. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Good luck.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys. Bye.